Corinth, what a city. Known for its temple to Aphrodite and its 1,000 temple prostitutes, the Greek term for acting Corinthian meant to practice fornication. At the crossroads of the ancient world, Corinth was visited by Paul on his second missionary journey, see Acts 18. He stayed 18 months, though strong opposition attempted to push him out of the city. But the gospel triumphed, and many Christians were saved out of this wicked environment. We ought to be thankful that first century believers got into all kinds of trouble, because we now have, in the epistles, divinely inspired answers to these problems. What issues does Paul deal with? First, in chapters 1 through 4, there's the recurring challenge of unity among God's people, the key to blessing. The enemy will seek in every way to weaken the church by division. So the apostle explains two principles. First, the gospel was designed to be propagated through the foolishness of preaching. Why? Because God has chosen what is weak and despised. So all who boast will boast only in the Lord. Boasting in anyone else is sure to cause division. Two, the second principle has to do with the Spirit's work in unifying God's people. How does He do this? By revealing the mind of Christ. If we all think the way the Lord does, this is the path to unity. Divisions cause stunted growth and loss of rewards. The letter then goes on to deal with moral problems in the church, chapters 5 and 6, with chapter 7 giving God's design for marriage. Chapters 8 through 10 asks, what to do when those around us want us to participate in pagan practices, in this case, eating food offered to idols? Note two warnings. Number one, be careful not to stumble a weak Christian who doesn't know better. And two, a believer must choose to either partake of the Lord's table or the table of demons. This section calls us to make choices for God's glory. Chapters 11 through 14 deal with issues related to public worship. First, the unveiled head of the man and the veiled head of the woman. The subject has nothing to do with culture. It has to do with the continuing theme of the glory of God, a main topic in the Corinthian epistles. The words to glory, to boast or have confidence in, occurs 21 times. The word doxa, meaning glory, praise, or worship, occurs 22 times. If my boast is in the Lord, I will consistently bring glory to His name. Paul then talks about the importance of the Lord's Supper, intended to be for the Lord's pleasure alone. Is this the most neglected meeting of the church? It should be the climax of the Lord's table, discussed in chapter 10, where the Spirit of God feeds me truth concerning Christ during the week. Then, after the time of self-examination, we gather to call to mind the Lord and His sacrificial death. The term, as often, probably doesn't mean as seldom, and the early believers did it weekly. See Acts 20, verse 7. This is followed by discussing spiritual gifts in chapters 12 through 14, with the classic portrait of love as the only fitting motive in our service for the Lord in chapter 13. Chapter 15 is the best passage on the truth of resurrection, both Christ's and ours. Chapter 16 concludes with some personal matters, giving us a taste of the sincere love and fellowship which the early believers enjoyed. And that's our scripture snapshot of the first epistle to the Corinthians.